All right, so on Monday, we talked about FPGAs, right? And we said that what you can do is you can have a general purpose processor and an FPGA, and you can put kind of like your high performance part of your application dedicated to the FPGA, and that can be a way to really focus your computation in a direct way. Today we're going to talk about having a dedicated purpose processor, which we're going to look at the Tensor processor, our processing unit, that's available at Google Cloud. And so as I was doing research on presenting this for today, one of the interesting things that I discovered is what motivated Google to decide to put this into their cloud facilities. So originally, what Google said is, we have so much extra compute power in all our data warehouses, we'll just, you know, sell that to other people and make a little profit off that. Same as like what Amazon did initially, right? If you think about how Amazon works, they said, hey, we need to have enough compute facilities for our peak service time. You know, say, I don't know, Black Friday or something like that. We need to be able to service our customers in that day sufficiently. But that's not the amount of service that we need to provide all year round. So we're going to build up for this peak thing, and what are we going to do with all that extra processing power in the meantime? Oh, I know, we can sell it to other people who might need it when we don't. And Google operated kind of on that same kind of mentality. But apparently in 2013, Google did a little back of the envelope calculation as they were starting to think about how their Android system, phone systems were going to be working, and they said that if just 3 minutes per day of audio search were to be used, which doesn't seem like a whole lot, right? 3 minutes of usage. That would require doubling their warehouse facilities. That's how much bandwidth all this audio search required using their standard CPUs. And so they said, hey, we gotta put this into gear quickly because we're gonna run out of compute facilities if we don't hurry. So that was kind of why they said we need a dedicated piece of hardware to deal with the type of software that would handle things like audio search. Okay. Did you have a question?
Yeah. When you say audio search, do you mean when they kind of start getting into like smart speakers, those sorts of things?
Yeah. Okay. So Apple Siri, Alexa, Amazon Alexa, Google Assistant. Yeah. So that was kind of the motivating behind Google saying we're going to put these facilities into our servers. Specifically, what they wanted to be able to do are deep neural networks, or DNN. Okay? So in order to understand our tensor processing unit being able to facilitate deep neural networks, we have to do the world's quickest primer on what a deep neural network is. Otherwise, the rest of it's not going to make a whole lot of sense. But this is not an artificial intelligence or even a machine learning class. So I'm going to skip over a lot of details on why this works, or how you might design a deep neural network, or what it might be useful, or and focus on some of the mechanical details of a deep neural network. All right. I know you two haven't taken either intro to AI or machine learning, and neither. Okay, so everyone's in the same boat there. Okay. So a deep neural network consists of these elements. Some people call them perceptrons, whatever. The way that it works is this node right here is going to have a bunch of incoming values, and it's going to do some computation and produce an output. Okay, that is our fundamental unit for a neural network. And usually the computation that takes place in here is we're going to have some sort of weighting. So weighting 0, weighting 1, weighting 2, all the way up to an nth weight. So for every input, we're going to have a separate weight that's associated with these inputs. And what we're going to do is we're going to multiply each of these inputs that we get by the appropriate weight for this. The machine learning part of this process is figuring out what these weights should be. Okay, so we're going to assume already that that process has taken place and that we've figured out what we think the proper weights are on this particular node right here. Okay? So then you're going to do this weighted sum of all these values, and then you're going to do what's in the literature called a nonlinear function. Well, it's not called a nonlinear function for any reason. It's because it is nonlinear in nature. But you're going to combine these in some way. And that could be a very simple nonlinear function. One of the most common ones is what's called the rectified linear function, which is just max of whatever your input is and zero. Right? So that just forces this value to always be non-negative. Right? But you can do exponentials, you can do hypertangent. There's a couple of commonly used nonlinear functions in here. Okay, so this is one node, and this is kind of the behavior. Now, I don't want to write this up over and over again because it will clutter the diagram. But whenever you see a node in what I describe next, think of it in terms of this weighted sum and a nonlinear function producing an output right here. All right? So the way most neural networks work is they have what are called layers. So you have some number of these nodes right here, and they don't always have to be the same number of nodes in a layer. Okay? And the number of layers is kind of like a black magic, dark art, kind of no one knows ahead of time what the right number of layers should be or how big each layer is, and you try to figure out using your expertise what that number of layers is. And eventually we'll get to this last layer right here. All right. Unsurprisingly, this is we'll have our input over here, and we'll have our output on the right. Right here.
So yes. Does this work under the same, like we did the vector processing?
Uh-huh.
Does this work under the same process, but except it's tensor? Yeah.
Everything. Let me develop it more, and that might be able to answer. You could, some artificial intelligence talk about vector processing, and you'll see why thinking along those lines is very helpful. But we might want to have an even more dedicated processor that doesn't just work with specific vectors, but with the particular setup we have here. Oftentimes, our neural networks are designed with inputs like images, or as I just mentioned, audio files, or something like that, and they're trying to ascribe some sort of meaning to these inputs. So for images, they oftentimes want to say, what's this a picture of? So if you've ever done a CAPTCHA or a reCAPTCHA, right? One of the reasons why they have those is to help train neural networks. So they want to say, here's a picture. As a human, do you find cars or stoplights or house numbers or, you know, any kind of feature on there? You say where on the picture it exists. They also run that picture against a neural network and try to see if they can write a neural network that will do as good of a job as identifying these particular features, and that word is a keyword in machine learning, features of the image as a human would, because then we can do all kinds of things like drive around the world with cameras on our car and figure out everything that exists in the world around us, kind of thing, right? Very interesting things. So the inputs might be pixels in an image, or the inputs might be a sample in your audio file, or whatever the case may be. And so the way most neural networks work is that they go ahead and pass these inputs to every single node in that first layer. Okay? Remember that each one of these nodes has a weight. In this case, we only have one input here. Well, we don't have more because we have multiple pixels. So there's a whole swath of values that are being passed to these nodes. What's different between these different nodes is that we've customized different weights for each one of these nodes. So you might get a different weight processing those inputs here than here, and so your output from this one is going to naturally be different than this one, and this one, and this one, and so on. Right. And then we do the same sort of thing at each layer. We take this, remember this only has one output, but we pass it to every one of these nodes. And we do the same thing, I'll do it with a different color just to make it clear. We pass the output from this node to each one of these. And we pass the output here. And so forth. So we fully connect all the inputs from this layer, all the outputs from this layer, to become inputs for every single one of the nodes on this layer right here. And we repeat that same process. The output from this layer goes to all the nodes here, and so forth. I'll just drop one more thing here. Make it click. And we repeat that through the entirety of each layer in our neural network here. All right. Does this connectivity make sense, how we're connecting up these nodes? Again, how many we do, why we put them in this way, and so forth, is the topic for a machine learning course. Okay, So now, what we have is we have, like you mentioned, Colin, we have a vector of weights at this point right here. And we have a different vector of weights at this point, and a third, and a fourth, and a fifth. And we have the same inputs coming into here as we have coming into here. The same inputts coming into here and here and so forth. So ultimately what we have is we have multiple inputs that we're doing the same type of operation at each one of these nodes. It's just the weights that are changing at these nodes. So what is oftentimes done is this becomes a vector matrix multiply. Right? Let's make sure we understand why, right? This input right here is the vector. You've got however many elements in your input right here is going to serve as the value that you keep repeating to multiply. And the weights at each one of these nodes serve as the matrix, because you want to multiply. If you remember, if you do a matrix times a vector, you're going to get a new vector as your output. And the way that this works, you'll remember, is that you take this row of this matrix and you take this column as this vector and you do the dot product between those two values to get this output value right here. And again, same type of thing. This column times this vector to get this. So if we arrange the weights for this node along this row right here, and we arrange the inputs that are coming into each node as this vector here, by doing the dot product between those two values, we're going to get the output from this node right here. And then we arrange each node as a row of weights, we'll not just get the output of this node, but we'll get the output of every one of these nodes right here. Is that making sense? Okay, cool. I see a lot of nodding heads. That makes me happy. So each one of these layers acts as a vector matrix multiply. The matrix for that layer is set up ahead of time, right? We've somehow learned what those weights should be. So these aren't values that are computed. They're values that are loaded into memory and used as appropriate. So you've got your matrix here, your matrix here, matrix here, and so forth. So then what you do for your model is you just store in memory somewhere each of the matrices that apply to each of the layers in your neural network. And then what you can do is you can send through your neural network not just one input image or one input audio value, but you can stream through many, many, many pictures or many, many, many audio streams, and you can get an output from them. All right. Then you can just apply your nonlinear function to this vector and then pass this vector to the next matrix or the next column. Right, and that's going to get you a new vector, and so on and so forth. All right. So what do you think Google's Tensor Processor Unit is really good at doing? Vector matrix multiply, right? All right. All right. So,
then on, like, for example, the new Apple M1 chips, they have the neural engine. Is that just something similar to this? It's just gonna, like,
I'm sure this is a big component of it, yes. Again, the M1 chips or the TPU chips might be used in different ways. What I'm not talking about here, but also is used, is you can build a neural network up, and instead of putting your input in and consuming what the output is, the machine learning portion of the process goes in a reverse direction. It's what's called back propagation of error through the neural network. And that's how you train the neural network what the right weights for each of those nodes should be. And you have to do some slightly different operations in order to support that. And it's possible that, I know for Google's Tensor Processing Unit, it's built to be able to support building these neural networks and executing these neural networks. It wouldn't surprise me if Apple's neural engine was only designed for the latter, executing a neural network, because it's meant to be put in a consumer product. Whether that's what they've done right now and released it for basically their MacBook line of processors, but conceivably they're going to be doing the same things with their iPhone processors as well. And so you don't want to be training a neural network on your laptop or on your phone, but you don't mind executing an already trained neural network on your laptop or phone, because the amount of computation to compute an already trained neural network is quite reasonable if you've got this nice architecture in place. To train it, however, can take days, weeks, or months, depending upon the size of your input set and how accurate you want to be and so forth. So that's not, I haven't done enough research into what Apple has put into the neural engine to know if it's meant to support both parts of executing a neural network, or if it just supports what we've talked about so far, that the execution of a neural network. All right. So these matrices can get quite large. For drawing purposes, I drew the layers so I could draw it in a reasonable amount of time. But each layer might have hundreds of thousands or millions of nodes in some really large cases, which is just crazy to think about. And until you think about how many pixels are in an image on a typical phone. So what they've done is they've basically built a 256 by 256 matrix vector multiply engine. And if you have more than 256 nodes in your layer, you just do the first 256 and then you load up the weights for the next 256, and then the weights for the next 256, and so forth. But this is a nice size. So that's a lot of elements, right? This is 2 to the 8th times 2 to the 8th, so that's 2 to the 16th, which is about 64,000 elements. So to load this up, it's going to take a bit of memory. And so what they've done to build this matrix vector multiply unit is they've internally, the way they've built their matrix vector multiply unit is with something called a systolic array. And this is supposed to apparently look like blood flowing through the heart or something like that. That's how it got it systolically. I have a hard time understanding that connection. But that's, I didn't name it, so I don't get to choose whether it makes sense or not. All right. So the key part of a systolic array is that we're going to have tons of ALUs. Okay? And so what we're going to do is, instead of storing all of our partial products to memory and then reloading them back from memory for the next computation, we're going to just put in a bunch of ALUs whose inputs are other ALUs. So we don't have any memory that we have to send data, partial sums or partial values, back to memory and then reload it back to memory. All right. Which sounds a little bit weird, so let me draw an example, a very simple example here. So, you know, kind of like this. No, that's fine. So you can see the array part, you know, this looks very much like an array. Here. Alright. And what I'm going to do is, in here, I'm going to do weight 1-1, weight 1-2, weight 1-3, weight 2-1, weight 2-2. And I'm going to load those into my systolic array. Since those don't change, I don't have to keep loading them over and over again. And now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to pass in X11, okay? And I'm going to tell this to multiply those two values together, all right? And I'm then going to pass this downward, and I'm also going to pass it over, okay? And that's my first time step. This is a clocked system because we need to make sure that the computation from each of these all gets synchronized in some way, shape, or form. So I'm going to make sure that during that first clock cycle, I send X1 in here. All right. In my next clock cycle, I'm going to send in X2. And notice that I've got three inputs here. This is, it, our ALU is able to do what's called a fuse, multiply, and add. So, I'm gonna multiply these two units. And I'm going to add that value within the proper order of operations. So we first multiply X12 with W12, and then we sum that product with the value that's coming in from here. And while that's going on, we're multiplying these values together, and basically we're passing in zero here. Okay? So that all of these always multiply these two values and add this third value that's coming in right here. Okay, that's our second clock cycle. Our third clock cycle, we make sure to pass X13 down here, because guess what? We have that same kind of behavior. So let me use green, black here. So our first clock cycle did this computation right here. Our second clock cycle did this computation right here. Our third clock cycle is going to do those three computations right here. Again, we're going to multiply these two values together, and we sum that value. And we get out, if this were a three-element vector matrix multiplied, we would get out after three clock cycles. Let's see what we get out. We get out X11 times W11. Plus X12 W12 plus X13 W13 right here. In the next clock cycle, then we will get out X11 W21 plus X12 W22 plus X13 W23. And in the next clock cycle, we get X11 W31 plus X12 W32 plus X13 W33.
But wouldn't there still be on the first, on the second one that we get out, wouldn't there still be the first X1 times W11? So that's the initial, everyone should have that. So it's the initial multiply. Right?
So what we might do is go like this.
So it's not always taking.
There you go.
So that one's taking the input, not the input.
Yeah, this edge one. Like that. Thank you. Good notes. Yeah. But you see this kind of wavefront where you start your computation here, you get more and more of these ALUs each clock cycle, and eventually you start spitting out a new one of these, which this represents the full, one full element of your result vector, the next element of your result vector, your next result of your vector, and so on. But we don't have to go to memory at all for this computation. After we load in our weights here, which hopefully, if we're doing the same neural network over and over again, these weights have been loaded, and all we have to do is stream in X1 through X however many element columns we have in here, one clock cycle after another. And so if we can keep our values streaming here, we can overlap tons and tons of computation with very limited memory operation.
So those three outputs, that would be the result of our vector times matrix.
Yeah.
That's getting a vector.
Right. The vector is up here, and our matrix is in here. And so this becomes a special kind of pipeline, right, where each new clock cycle, after we go through each of these ALUs, each new clock cycle you're spitting out another value from your output vector. Yeah. They have some other parts to their processor as well. They have, this gets stored in what Google calls its accumulator, and passes it to another part of the processor that can do the nonlinear functionality part of that. And they've intentionally designed their processor so that the systolic array for the matrix vector multiplied here can be executing at the same time as the, I forget what they call this, the activator is what this is called. Okay, and the activator executes these nonlinear functions right here at the same time as this is happening, so they try to overlap as much computation as possible, so that while you're computing one matrix vector multiplied for one part of the neural network, you're computing the nonlinear functionality of a different part of the neural network. So they try to have as much of that overlapping execution as possible. And so, then, again, you don't have to go back to memory to get this final output. Here, then, you can send this output to your memory. All right. Questions on this? All right. There are some other features that I'm intentionally not going into because I think it would require a deeper understanding of neural networks and how they operate. But I want you to see how, by understanding how neural networks work, at a fundamental level, layer, as a computer architect, you can say, hey, if I can build a system that does matrix vector multiply really well, I'm going to solve this particular application area's deepest performance requirement most significantly. And so even though Moore's law is not allowing me to accelerate the advance of computation at the same rate it did 15, 20, 30 years ago, because I'm building a special purpose piece of the hardware that takes into account the most important algorithm that software needs, this particular application area continues to see the same kind of performance improvement that you would expect from Moore's law applying to broadly across any type of algorithm. And so that's why your authors have really gotten into this, what they call DSA, which is a domain-specific architecture, as being the way forward for continuing to produce performance from your applications. That's why FPGAs are so interesting that we talked about on Monday, because they can be designed for a particular domain and sped up in that way. So two different approaches to that problem. The reason why things like tensor processing units are so interesting is that it's not a niche domain. In other words, once people started seeing machine learning work, they said, oh, well, we can apply machine learning to this and to that and to this other thing. And all of a sudden it seemed like we can utilize this to solve quite a number of problems that we wanted to solve. And so even though it is domain specific, that domain applies to a large range of problems. And so then it becomes valuable enough to build a tensor processing unit into a Google scale warehouse because they can use it so frequently, or they can sell its use so frequently. All right. And so that's where computer architecture appears to be headed over the next decade or so, is building these kind of domain-specific architectures that, while are targeted towards a particular domain, seem to be useful in a large range of realistic applications. All right. I want to leave a few minutes for questions about the final project, but I want to remind you that Monday, our last class, will be our final exam. It will cover chapter 6 in your textbook, which is the parallel processing that we've talked about, as well as our two lectures this week. And again, I've posted the lecture for Monday already in Slack. I will post this lecture shortly today on Slack, and so you'll be able to use those to review if you want to. But that will be the topic. So it will be a little bit shorter than the first two exams, since it's only one chapter in your book and a couple extra lectures on top of that.
And that includes FPGA and then this?
Yes. Obviously, since you don't have text to review FPGA and the tensor processing unit, I'm going to just base it on what we talked about in class, talk about, you know, why tensor processing units, how deep neural networks are designed, and how a processor could advance a neural network. For an FPGA, we could talk about things like, what a cell is comprised of, how a LUT can do any arbitrarily complex 3, 4, 5 input Boolean expression, how that then makes them programmable, and then how you have to handle routing as well, and how that becomes programmable. And the combination of the two then allow you to build up any more complicated electrical circuit.
So we need to know how a systolic array works in detail, or
You should understand, that the inputs of a systolic array in the middle of the systolic array are other ALUs. They're not memory values, right? So, and this is just a part of the systolic array, right? It has many more columns and rows. In fact, 256 to be specific, right? So you have 256 values, and you're computing 64,000 computations with those 256 values. So low memory load, high computational output from that. So are there any quick questions about your final project?
If I'm heading home for break, what would be the best way to get my project to work? I've been running it through machines and stuff.
How I did stuff for this class over quarantine where I couldn't really access. The school still has the VPN open, which allows you to get to Matt. Or if you go through John, I mean either.
I've been using like I think Putty to.
Yeah. You should still be able to.
Putty work.
To John it does.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, so I just logged on to John, and then you can do all like your coding like in Windows as long as your test executable gets over to John.
Yeah, so you can do like a secure copy from your machine to.
Alright, I just didn't know if it would let me.
Yes,
connect
to
connect to John.
To John you can. To the other resources and once you have the VPN.
If you have the
John.cse.dealer.dev.
If you have the VPN set up, you can even do from like downloads and then move it into your X drive if you have that moved up to your .com. And then your X drive into your .com.
Yeah, I've got my X drive set up, but I don't know if I've been connecting to it through John. Probably connecting it through there.
Yeah, so once you set it up through the VPN. And there's instructions on the Moodle and Canvas page on how to do that.
Okay.
You had a question?
Yeah, so I think we're to the point where we're ready to start testing.
Uh-huh.
But we still haven't really built like an assembly yet.
Uh-huh.
Is there any like anywhere where we could get like a test data.bin while we're still trying to write our own?
Yeah, there are some. If you go on the history of the Slack channel, last year several students posted example binaries.
Yeah. So could it be okay to use those?
Yep.
Or
mm-hmm.
do we need to eventually make our own?
You probably will want to make your own just because you don't know it for debugging purposes.
Yeah,
like if you get their binary, like what's it doing? If they said it's going to work like this, and my machine doesn't, well, why is it supposed to work like that? What you're going to have to do is reverse assemble the code to figure out what it's doing in the first place. So, yeah, you can use it, and if your thing magically works the first time,
that'd be amazing.
Yes, that would be amazing. That'd be awesome. I'd love for that to happen to you. Realistically, but that's at least a good starting point.
And another thing, we have the control.reset function. Where do we want to do that? What exactly is that doing? It's in in the example code you gave us, it's in the memory. It's at the end of the memory initialization. Does that need to happen at the end of all the code? Or at the
yes,
end
of at the end of your CPU constructor. Just because the idea is because of how I set up the framework, when you make a connection between two components, I have my framework send signals to the, so you've got some component, and it's got some output. It's always got some output. And so when you connect, you make this connection between this component and this component, my framework says, hey, there was an output here, you might want to know that, and so I'm going to send that output to this newly connected thing, which, if you're talking about a physical component, that doesn't make sense. When you turn on the electricity, right, it's all there and working, but with the simulator, you've got some sort of, sequential serialization going on. And as a result, when my software sets up these initial signals, it can confuse the control about, oh wait, I just received a signal from memory. That means it wants to do something, right? Or a signal from or from somewhere else. And so it completely screws up the state machine. So after you've connected all of the different components,
you just reset it,
and so then it's really good. Which, to be honest, if you look at how hardware is built, when it's bootstrapping the hardware, they will have a reset line that usually is high until everything is going, and then they'll set it low, right? So this is kind of trying to mimic that kind of reset line. Yeah, and I'll be online to try to help answer questions. I'll definitely be around through when you're here on campus to help you in person, and then hopefully, obviously, I'm not going to be online for Thanksgiving Day, but I don't expect you to be either. But after that, and before the assignment is due, I will continue to be online and try to answer as many questions as I can of you and try to help facilitate you succeeding in the project.
And this is due next Monday? Like, not this upcoming Monday, but the Monday after break?
It's due when the final exam for this class would be due.
So I think that's Monday.
I forget exactly.
Okay. I guess I do have another question. We talked about it, and I forgot to write it down, and that's on me. But converting like an integer to binary, just like
for you mean
like to somewhere?
Oh, for storing an integer from a program into a file.
Yes.
Yeah.
It seems like the assembler is fairly straightforward when you're just like setting up what the integer should be.
Yes.
And then actually getting it to the file.
So you've got some integer that has some value that you initialize it to. You do or and we can use this. Right. And then sometime later, assuming that you're at the point in the file where you want to write this integer right here, and that's either because you've written other integers before it, or you did a call that lseek to get to the right spot, you would do a write to this file descriptor right here, the integer that you want to store with right, that would be the C++ way of doing this, right, because this tells which file to write to, this gives the buffer, the pointer to the location in memory that you want to write, and this gives the number of bytes that you want to write. And so then it's just a matter of setting up your integer to have the right value.
So is it okay to have two different files? Like, is it okay to open a file and then also write to a file? Like,
okay.
I have what I have right now is I have like an assembly.txt where I'm like actually putting in assembly language and then convert. Going to convert it and then write it.
Right,
so I would be able to have another
in
FD.
Well, yeah, so you do, like, so maybe, I mean,
like
so like this, is, so like out FD, you would want another one like in FD, and that would be, you know. That, right?
And
so you've got two different file descriptors, one for what you're reading from, one that you're writing to.
And we don't need a mode for the create.
Right, it's default.
Okay.
Yeah. And if you're using C++, you can just use an F stream and read in because you're using text read. So you might not even use this this open. You might just
not CN.
Well, you could,
yeah.
But that's actually how I wrote my assembler, is that I piped the assembly to my assembler, and so it does actually read from standard. you, gentlemen.